Well, thanks everybody. It's pretty cozy now in here, so we are among ourselves. And I'm not sure if the presentation is up there yet. I'll talk about beauty, if that fits with you. Exactly. So, not too long ago, I went and spoke at a conference in Lisbon. And it was at a medieval castle at the Castle São Jorge, which is hovering above Lisbon. This is a medieval military compound, a functioning building basically made to stop intruding armies by shooting cannonballs at them. And nevertheless, if you look at this castle, almost every aspect of it, look at that entryway, is informed by form. Somebody considered how to get into this castle very, very carefully. Look at the symmetry. Every doorknob on that castle is covered with ornament and is chiseled. And even the cannons themselves are actually quite elegantly finished. From Lisbon, directly, I went to Memphis, Tennessee, and I spoke at the Cook Convention Center. This is a... I went outside and looked around. And nothing that you see, if you look around the Cook Convention Center, you could reasonably say has been made with a formal consideration in mind. It's just whatever which way, let's do it this way. The only remnant of Memphis culture that you could see is woven into that carpet of this hall. I'm not sure if you can make it out. There is, I think, some musical notes and things like that. So Elvis had truly left that building. This is the Marriott Hotel that's connected to the Cook Convention Center. It's never a good sign when you have a photo of a lobby that needs a caption. That's the caption underneath that photo or on the other side. Now, how is that possible? Like, how did we actually manage to get from Lisbon to Memphis? How is it possible that we got from the darkest side of the Middle Ages into the 20th century and completely lost our desire to make something beautiful? Well, I can tell you I blame one single guy, my fellow Austrian architect Adolf Loos, who lived in, you know, late 19th century Vienna. And of course, he lived at the end of the 19th century. He was obsessed with beauty. The era was historicism. They built whatever they wanted, whatever which way. So this is the city hall, which they made Gothic. This is the parliament, which is Greek. And then this is the opera, which is Renaissance. And there was a reason to kind of stop this, because, you know, Loos thought this is the new age, the machine age. We should really do something that is fitting to that age. And he wrote a pamphlet that became very, very famous called Ornament and Crime, in which he basically said that it's a crime to waste the time of craftsmen, if you're an architect, with something as silly and like ornamentation, that we would really have to look at functionalism. Now, Loos, of course, was a gigantic influence on the Bauhaus. The Bauhaus became the major influence on architecture and design for the next 100 years. And a lot of this, or some of this, made sense at the time. You know, modernism reflected the power of technology. Optimization needed to be embraced, and the machine age really started visually. And of course, some of the leading proponents of the Bauhaus, Mies van der Rohe, Corbusier, Gropius, emerged as some serious creators and did create a number of masterpieces. This actually is one by Loos himself. But then, I'll leave this one. This is on Michaela Platz in Vienna, where it is said that the residency of the Austrian emperor opposite, that he actually had his windows nailed shut because he wouldn't have to look at this ugly Loos house that he hated so much because it had no or very little ornament on it. And it was known in Vienna as the house without eyebrows because, you know, most houses, of course, looked like this at the time. The second generation, though, the generation that came afterwards, you know, took these ideas of functionalism and then made a kind of economic functionalism out of that, and wound up basically covering vast landscapes of the earth, both in the Eastern Bloc as well as in capitalist countries, with this psychotic sameness. You know, Corbusier himself very famously wanted to tear down all of Paris and replace it with this. And for every Seagram building, for every masterpiece that we got in Midtown Manhattan, we also got 100 of these out in Queens. And if you look at it, they actually look remarkably close to what Corbusier had in mind for Paris. This whole thing, of course, is incredibly silly and quite unbelievably stupid. If you look at the oldest tools that we've had, this is a hand axe. We've used that for a million years, all the way until up to 40,000 years ago. There was no tool in human history that we've had so many and we've used for such a long time. We found hundreds of thousands of them. I bought one on eBay for $200 recently. We found them in Africa, we found them in Europe, we found them in the Americas, and all of them are perfectly symmetrical. Now, you could skin that mammoth just as well with a tool that's not symmetrical. It was made symmetrical because it was better looking, because it was more beautiful. And I'd say that that is somehow meaningful. There were hand axes found that were this big. So you couldn't use them at all. They were too heavy. You couldn't lift them up. They were just made because one could, because they were that good looking. This is much younger. This is only 15,000 years ago, a spear thrower. I mean, look at the beauty of this thing. To throw a spear, you do not need this to have to be in a shape of a mammoth. It was just desire, the desire of us to make it look gorgeous. So I'm absolutely convinced that beauty is part of what it means to be human. It's at the very, very center of what we are actually about. And nevertheless, right now, if I look at my own profession, at design, there is basically not a single high-end designer who talks about beauty, meaning nobody. Beauty is seen somewhere below kitsch. Kitsch, at least, you know, it's ironic, it's palatable. But beauty, nobody talks about. Same, of course, in contemporary art. If you've been here for the panel, you will not have heard the word beauty mentioned anywhere close. Now, I just 5 minutes ago ran into Jeff Koons. Is he here? Well, he is around. And he proved that you can actually build an entire career, or at least part of a career, on kitsch. You couldn't do the same thing with beauty. And understand that, you know, when Duchamp came along, that there was a need to end that era of the 19th century, and there was a need to introduce sexuality and disgust and horror into what it means to be human. And I'm not saying we should get rid of all of that. I'm just saying that I'd be very ready for a reintroduction of beauty. It's a friend of mine, Chris McManus, a research psychologist, and he developed an interesting test using a very quintessential modernist. This, of course, is the work of Mondrian. Now, my friend Chris took an original Mondrian and then he faked a Mondrian. Now, let's see a show of hand. Who thinks the one on the left is the real Mondrian? About 20 people. Who thinks the one on the right is the real Mondrian? About 10 people. There is the one on the left, so we have 20 to 10 who say who got this right. Let's do another test. Who thinks the one on your left is the real Mondrian? 5 people. Who thinks the one on the right is the real Mondrian? Well, it's a clear vote. And you've got it correct. So clearly, we know something about beauty and we agree on something about would-be beauty. Now, the strange thing is that, of course, even Adolf Loos very, very much believed in beauty. This is a glass that he designed in 1910. It's still in production by the same company in Vienna, Lobmeier, until now. And when he designed it, he sent a letter with it that said he could also see little ornaments going on there, like butterflies or small insects or possibly the naked human form. And ironically, Lobmeier commissioned my studio to design that ornamentation onto the glass of the guy who wrote Crime and Ornament. So we designed the 7 deadly sins and the 7 heavenly, Seven heavenly virtues. So you have on the sin side, you have this is greed, gluttony, lust, pride, wrath, sloth, and envy. And on the positive side, on the virtue side, you have humility, chastity, charity, diligence, kindness, temperance, and patience. And of course, at the end, this is not about simple versus complex. It really, of course, is all about, was it done with love and care, or was it done without thought? And I do think, actually, that things do become better. I mean, we are at this very spot at the extreme west side of New York. If you take the quintessential utilitarian functional building, a train track for an elevated train track that's been, of course, empty for a very long time. I'm sure all of you, most of you have been up there in the meantime. When Robert Hammond and Joshua Davis came along and did put a lot of love and care into it, had it renovated by architects Stiller and Scofidio, and the result, I'm sure everybody here is aware of it, is the almost universally loved High Line from 12th to 30th Street. Completely transformed the neighborhood that we are in, inspired billions of dollars of new construction, and maybe one of my favorite little facts about it is that in the 4.5 years that it's been open, not a single handbag has been stolen on the High Line. There's not a single crime had been reported on the High Line since it opened. And even the buildings that surround the High Line seem to be somehow better than they are in other parts of the city. So I do think that beauty is at the very, very heart of the function. If the High Line would not have been renovated with that kind of love and care, it would not be this successful. So I do think that things get better. You know, civilization actually does work. We might go down a wrong track here and there, but ultimately we do right ourselves again. And I'm of course a designer, and so we designed a little piece of typography for a sentence that basically says exactly that. Thanks a lot. Thank you.